Welcome to the Lodge. You've accessed
the Lodgecast Experience.
Warning, warning. Dangerous spoilers ahead. Enjoy.
It's hot takes, y'all. It's been a while since we've hot taken anything. And some people have asked, guys, what is a hot take? And that's a good question. Hot takes are if a movie is going to be seen by everybody and we don't need to necessarily go through the plot painstakingly beat by beat.
Yeah.
Or if we see the movie separately so we can't do the preamble or we're getting pumped.
Yeah.
Or if a movie just... we just disrespect it. We're like, fuck, we're not doing a full episode.
Or in this case, the preamble would have been a complete headache because we were going to the Egyptian
theater. And this movie is 3.5 hours long. The movie is The Irishman. I'm Elijah, mess with me as always. It's Brother Bishke. Yeah. Brother Lucas is in the trunk.
No, Tommy. No, doctor.
We're doing a little homage. We're doing a little Scorsese homage. Plus, we just got so many boys. This Prius is packed to the gills with boys. We got Brother Ben.
Hello, hello, hello.
Brother Josh returning for his first time in a Prius.
Hey!
He was on the Matrix cast, Al Fresco, and now you're in the recirculated air. How are you feeling?
I am excited to have my Prius cherry popped.
Yeah. Well, this is the one to do it. And a returning champion... a guru among gurus, Brother Dave.
Gotta do the podcast. Do the podcast.
Oh, man. How are we alive right now? That was 3.5 horas of what what the fuck
is
just happened?
Is that the longest movie I've ever seen?
Yeah, we were talking about that. What is the longest movie you guys have seen in the theater? Is this it?
I think that's it.
Yeah. It might be it.
I think that's it.
Lucas and I were talking about the Heaven's Gate director's cut that we witnessed at the Egyptian.
Yeah.
But this might, for all intents and purposes, let's say this is it. And I felt it. I felt like it was 3.5 hours long, I have to say.
I aged.
Agreed. Yeah.
Yep.
So we're not even going to try to touch the plot. It's Robert De Niro in all ages, all styles. We got Joe Pesci. We got Al motherfucking Pacino. And they're all mixing around grumpy old gangster style. I didn't know shit about this movie going in. I never watched the trailer. I mean, did you guys know anything?
We watched the first trailer long ago. But yeah, I didn't remember much. I knew it looked expensive.
It was expensive from the trailer,
and it was expensive. And I knew it was about Hoffa tangentially. But yeah, that's all I knew.
Did you guys all know this was a Hoffa movie?
No, nope. That's what I was.
Okay, because
yeah.
I thought this was going to be like Sharon Tate in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Like I thought Hoffa was going to be there, but woven into the back. I didn't know Al Pacino was going to be hoo-ah front and center through most of this movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
like. I did not see that coming.
Yeah.
Lucas, in the way back, did you know about this?
No. I only actually heard recently, earlier this week, that somebody was like, Pacino's going to win Best Supporting Actor for this movie. You heard it here first. And I was like, for what? And they were like, for Hoffa, man. And I was like, you mean Jack Nicholson?
right.
Well, made a movie called Hoffa.
He did. What my main concern is, okay, so the movie starts out, you're just in Scorsese land. You got the wall-to-wall music. You got De Niro de-age, which I surprisingly didn't mind.
Yeah, let's just get all the first takes on the de-aging and what do we think about that?
Because they hit you right away with it.
Because they're at their youngest right away. What is our takes on the de-aging? I'm going to say, I was like, I'm going to get used to this. And I eventually did, but it was pretty deep fake to me because they took De Niro's eyes and made them blue.
Yeah. And it really
made him look kind of glassy. And
he's the Irishman.
But the faces were good, but then they didn't really de-age the bodies, which we'll get to.
Yeah.
They moved the faces, but you didn't move the bodies.
There's some body movements, but I'm interested to just hear other people's facts. Yeah. The de-aging.
Round table of de-aging.
What do we think
here
on the de-aging?
One of the only things I had heard coming into this was how terrible the de-aging was, how shitty it looked. And so when we get that first De Niro reveal, yeah, it's Uncanny Valley, but I didn't think it was terrible.
Well, we were expecting, yeah, like,
I thought for some reason Pacino's de-aging looked better, like light years better than De Niro's and Pesci's. I was confused why Pacino suddenly like looked better.
Pacino de-aged. Also probably has had more work done.
I think that's,
yeah.
But the one thing that I wanted to say is, so this movie is spanning, what, approximately 40 years, mm-hmm, maybe 50 years. And I don't know if anybody else, but I just, the de-aging stuff was inconsistent or something. I was having a really, and we were jumping around chronologically.
Yeah.
So I was having a really hard time of like gauging.
I was watching their glasses styles.
Yeah.
And that's about it.
De Niro always just sort of read 50 to me, no matter what. No matter where we were.
Agreed. I felt they should have cast younger actors in the very beginning, in like the 40s or whenever Pesci and De Niro first meet cute. It's like, dude, just cast younger peeps.
Yeah. It didn't bother me, though. I have other problems.
Remember
but
when
that
movies used to do
me.
That, though? They used to do that. They used to cast younger
actors. But listen.
Goodfellas. Yeah, Goodfellas.
Listen, this movie is presented as, and is in fact, a last hurrah for these boys.
Yeah.
Playing together one last time. Let's get the gang back together. They're not going to farm that out to, like, Miles Teller, you know?
No.
Like, I would love to see De Niro play 15 in this. I don't give a fuck. As long as he and Pesci are meet-cutin' and they're up to hijinks.
Yeah.
And, you know, like, as long as that's cooking, I'm fine with it.
Yeah.
Okay, Josh, de-aging thoughts. That sigh can stand on its own, but
for like, I don't know, like the first initial meeting, I was like, yeah, like, okay, they look kind of weird, but I'm fine with it. And then I noticed the mouths.
Oh, shit.
And the mouths always looked really, really Polar Express.
Oh, shit.
To me, where I was just like, this is not right. Like, this is like, and also in my head, I was trying to figure out how this all worked on like a practical level, like what were they doing? And then I got really used to De Niro.
Right.
But Pesci consistently looked weird. Like, it's almost like his skin was translucent.
He's weird as it is. He's always looked weird. So he's not going to suddenly look normal.
Yeah.
But I agree.
I think they had to do the most with Pesci, too. Like,
because he's
saggy.
He's really saggy now.
He's 20 years out of the game. So
Yeah. Brother Dave, what are your thoughts here?
I would put early De Niro on a Welcome to Marwin scale at about he was about an 8.
Yes, that's a good point. We're going to need to implement the Marwin scale because this shit is not going away. It is only going to happen more often because there will continue to be an ever-growing dearth of bankable, cool actors that everybody loves. So we're going to get, like, D.H. Jack Nicholson at some point. Real soon.
Yeah.
I'm surprised he wasn't in this. Let's develop the Marwin scale right now.
Yeah.
So 10 is like you want to puke looking at it because you just don't want to, you've forgotten what being human means. And 1 is like just a dusting where it's like, guys,
they took the wrinkles out.
Yeah, you took the wrinkles out. I see you. So what would you give it on this newfangled Marwin scale?
8 for me.
That's an 8. Okay.
Yeah, I'm at about a 7. They got work to be done. Where there's work to be done.
Okay. All right. Well, so let's talk about the bodies. We got way bigger fish to fry here. But suffice it to say, you can de-age a face, but the movements. When De Niro is kicking the shit out of a shop owner,
that was the most old man.
It was
fighting I've ever seen.
It was dirty grandpa.
Yeah.
It was
pulls him out of the grocery store. Yeah, yeah. And it, and his, you could just
they
tell.
Were, they was, were trying to make it be like a badass De Niro beatdown moment.
Yeah.
But the editing wasn't doing him any favors either because it was like all a wide shot.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. and he's stomping on him, and he's just kind of like pressing down on his hand on the curb, which you're like, oh, the guy's screaming, and you're like, I guess that's painful, but it's just an old man.
I thought they should have shot it from his daughter's POV, right? Because he, like, marches her down there, and you're right, they shoot it from this clunky fucking, like, ooh, yeah, master, and it's like, dude, this is not dramatic at all. Like, we see it coming a mile away, and it's just, yeah, just awkward. It's just bad.
Yeah.
Lucas, that is an expert segue. Seeing it coming a mile away. Listen, I was loving this movie. I was loving every morsel of it. It was like Goodfellas nostalgia.
It was very cozy.
It was moving. It was cozy. Yeah. It was comfort food. Yeah. But the second that old hoo-ha comes on screen, it's a balloon to me. It's a balloon that slowly deflates because the second you see him, De Niro's like, no kids today know who Jimmy Hoffa is. Well, maybe they know he disappeared, but they don't know him. Okay. It's inevitable. Hoffa's a fucking dead man.
Yeah.
If you somehow stumble into this movie as someone who doesn't know what happened to Jimmy Hoffa, why even include that line? You're getting rid of the only shred of tension that you're going to be dealing with for the next literally 2.5 hours. So Hoffa comes in and we lose the dynamic between De Niro and Pesci that's just starting to heat up. You see them start to move together, like De Niro's rising in the ranks. They drop a Keitel on us.
Yeah, yeah.
And you're like, holy shit, I can't wait to see these trio get to work. Nope, you're going to Chicago, son, and you're going to watch Al Pacino swallow the scenery whole. Again, it's welcome, but, you know, you don't want to eat cotton candy as a main course.
Yeah, and Pacino's hunchbacked.
And he sporadically tries a Chicago accent. Did you guys notice that?
No.
There's, like, one scene when they're visiting him in prison where he tries to throw on a little, like, oh, yeah, they go down there, then, yeah, yeah. But, no, he's full Pacino mode.
Uh-huh.
Now, maybe I'm just dumb, but I don't find inside baseball union talk to be scintillating and scintillating enough to be the only thing that's going on.
Yeah.
What say y'all?
Agreed.
Like, was anybody on the edge of their seat during the center 2 hours of this film?
Nope. No.
Oh, Lucas.
No. I was pretty into it, I gotta say.
Okay, thank you. Please enlighten us.
I just didn't know exactly where it was going, and I thought the acting carried it and the dialogue was snappy enough that I kept waiting for that other shoe to drop. So even though I hear what you're saying about that line giving away Hoffa's demise, I was still waiting to see how it was going to happen and who would be responsible if the De Niro character would actually betray him.
Right. I think what my problem is, there is always that going on, but the dialogue for wide swaths of it is just about
pensions,
union president elections,
yeah,
all this shit where it's like you gotta throw, like, we have this concurrent thread going where they're older and they're driving to this wedding with their wives, and that is kind of abandoned. Like, I was like, when they set up all these threads, all these time threads, I'm like, ooh, this is going to cook into a real nice, tight, snappy, like, tense ending where everything comes together in a symphony.
Yeah.
It's not interested in that, which is fine, but I'm just like, my eyes are rolling in the back of my head for a lot of it, you know? Because there's that crackling synergy between De Niro and Pesci. All the posters are touting it. That's what you're here for. And then they just separate them. And when they come back together, I'm like, oh, yeah, I remember you guys knew each other. And he gives them a ring, and it's like, this is touching, but it would have been way more touching if we would have checked in with these motherfuckers a little bit more throughout this movie. Anyway,
this is an old man's gangster movie.
It didn't really feel written. I mean, Steve Zaillian is an Oscar winner, but I honestly felt like they were winging the whole thing.
Well,
like, there's not really one audition scene in 3.5 hours. Not one.
Please pipe in if you disagree with any of this. But I feel like it's so redundant. There is a slight that happens in prison between Al Pacino and the guy who played Capone on Boardwalk Empire. and they talk about it for an hour. They talk, and I get that that's gets the ball rolling that eventually gets him killed, but who gives a fuck? Do I emotionally care about that? Have that bubbling in the background while you're doing something else.
I really wish the scope had been narrowed. I understand him wanting to do epic. I understand him wanting, you know, this is their big last hurrah. But I honestly think if they had cut large swaths out of the Hoffa stuff and just focused on his, I don't know. I just, it lost me so hard. But for that first hour, I was like, oh, shit.
Because they're building characters.
Yeah.
And then they just stall out in Hoffa land.
But the character building wasn't super compelling to me. I thought
it was going somewhere.
Yeah,
I was ready to welcome them in. I'm like, you guys are going back to the Goodfellas well, but I'm here for it.
I'm sorry. That first out. Yes. That was exactly right. But then they
abandon it.
But then they abandon it into Pacino land, and I was.
And they go, they just, zoning. They cover the same territory over and over. Josh and I went to the bathroom when there was a phone call between Pacino and De Niro where they were setting up the meeting that would ultimately spell his doom, which, great, you know, that can be tense, but it wasn't.
Well, it played out in real time.
It played out in completely real time.
Real time.
And by the way, I started making mental notes on how to fill you in. You know,
you need to.
And then you guys came back and there's literally a conversation that recaps everything that just happened the previous 5 minutes. And I was like, well, shit, don't need to do that.
Yeah.
I didn't actually really have to go to the bathroom that bad at that point, but
that's damning.
But I had just been in such hell for like the past hour that I was like, I feel like I've seen the same scenes repeated.
Tell us about your hell. What led you to this?
It was just like, I don't know. I mean, I didn't love it that much from the beginning anyway.
Oh, yeah. And I was not in from the opening shot when it's clunky. I think it was a handheld.
The Knives Out review is early here.
It was like this weird. I thought at first, like, oh, we're doing like a Steadicam, but then it was like too shaky as it kind of goes down this old folks' home hallway.
Lucas has got some deep
into
notes.
A dining room. There's a guy in a wheelchair. They kind of pan around him, and it's like shaky, but in a bad, like, student feature way.
No.
It's like, what? This is your fucking opening shot?
You dropped the student feature bomb.
And then De Niro, starts talking to no one, right? But then at the end of the movie, he's talking to a priest, and I'm thinking, why wouldn't you use the priest as, like, a framing device? Like, you know, Amadeus or some shit. Like, this is just bad filmmaking.
Well,
it felt like Scorsese wrote this, like, when he was a teenager and, like, sat on it for 80 years.
Well, here's the thing. With the narrator convention, it's hilarious that even at the end, I get that De Niro's old and, like, losing his edge a little bit, but even at the end where he's narrating and he's just like, and then that other guy died. I don't know. You know how it goes.
He just trails off.
And listen, before you come at me and say, it's about the decay of his soul mirroring the decay of his body for sins that he can't be forgiven. Yeah, I get it. I get it. It's not compelling.
Got it. Got it.
Got
it. Got it for the last 45 minutes. Got it for the last 30. Got it for the last 15.
Brother Dave, is this sacrilegious? What are we doing here?
No, it's not sacrilegious, but I do feel like I have to be a contrarian in the Prius because I don't know if it was like the cherry Coke that I drank giving me a ton of energy, but I don't know if I'd say I was on the edge of my seat, but I was into this movie from beginning to end, and I felt even though it was long, it didn't feel that long to me, and I felt like, especially, to me it felt a little bit like a course corrective for Marty. He might have taken the criticism that his gangster movies glorify the characters, because that last, like, half hour or 45 minutes,
it's not glorifying.
Long, no, and he does it from the beginning of the movie, too, by introducing these characters like he would in Goodfellas or Casino,
right,
but then throwing on screens like, oh, this guy, he got shot six times in the head.
Yep.
And it just keeps happening, and it keeps repeating. And yes,
it just reminds you that crime don't pay, y'all.
Yeah, it's not all fun and games, and De Niro's character I thought was really interesting. Like, I'd never embraced him. He was never fun like a Henry Hill.
No.
He was just always had this tragic numbness about him. I don't know if that was the uncanny valley.
It was like Frankenstein's monster.
It was bizarre, but it worked for me, and I can't really argue with the criticisms of it being a little overlong or too union politicky. But to me, like, all the politics was kind of tied into the organized crime. So I was looking for the connections, and it honestly reminded me, it made me kind of want Scorsese to do a Trump movie.
There, oh, God. There's so many Hoffa-Trump parables. Yeah, I leaned over to Brother Ben, and I'm after one of Pacino's huge meltdown scenes. I'm just like, the second this hits Netflix, they're going to deep fake Trump onto this body. Oh, he was even wearing a red tie and a suit. He's a little bloated.
Brother Dave, I'm curious. What do you...
This isn't a setup.
No, because I'm really curious, because I was struggling with this during the movie. What do you feel is... What's De Niro's character's name? Frank?
Irishman.
Yeah, yeah. What do you feel is his arc through the movie? Or what do you feel is his, like, progression? Because I felt like he started at one point and ended at the same point. And I don't always need, like, a big, huge character arc, but I like some change.
Yeah, so, Dave, did he grow?
What do you feel
did
like
was
that? Yeah.
I mean, that's between him and his God.
Fair enough.
It doesn't appear that he did, but he did lose his family. And I think that's supposed to, I don't know, it worked for me. I don't know if it worked for you guys. They make a big deal of, you know, his daughter watching him and disapproving of him and ultimately rejecting him.
But he doesn't even really see that until the end. Like, he doesn't see that nice Godfather homage with the door closing while she's watching him and all that shit.
There's the bank scene.
There's the bank scene, but that's at the very end. Like, he doesn't seem conflicted. Yeah, he seems mildly annoyed that he has to kill a friend.
I was waiting for a big Anna Paquin scene, but she gets one line.
Dude, nobody gets any lines.
They drop
Paquin Jesse Plemons almost didn't speak until the last fucking half hour.
They drop a Plemons on us, and they don't even use him.
They don't use him.
What was it? They use him for an extended fish monologue where I was
fish
just
scene.
I was ready. I was like, this is fucked up. This is fucked up. I leaned over to Ben. I'm like, we're supposed to keep it muted. I try to keep it professional, but I had to say, what is going on here? What is going on here?
That was my favorite aside, but my ultimate favorite Lodge Master aside was, I could really go for some Rolling Stones right about now.
I was waiting for it.
We were taking instead,
you get this chintzy, cheesy fucking Ennio Morricone.
Let's talk about the scores.
Once upon a time, Robbie Robertson.
It's a good score.
Robbie Robertson on the harmonica. And we also get...
I loved the theme song.
Santo and Johnny's Sleepwalk, which doesn't help.
The theme song... I was rocking with at the beginning, and I was laughing at the end, so the theme song pleased me. And I agree, Sleepwalk, and watching Al Pacino in his PJs slowly falling asleep on a hotel bed also ain't gonna help with the pacing. No. Sorry, guys. Yeah. But let's talk some more about the music. We were taking bets about whether Sympathy for the Devil was gonna make an appearance. It did not.
No stones
whatsoever. But listen, guys. This movie was wall-to-wall Scorsese greatest hits until we maybe get to the middle of it. And then there's no music.
Yeah, it goes
quiet. And I was thinking about it early during one of these long committing crimes suites. I was like, how would this play without music here? And I thought to myself, this would be like if you were just watching the silent dailies, would you know that this was a Scorsese masterpiece?
Fuck no, dude. This is like the most non-Scorsese movie I've ever had to sit through.
Right. So when we are treated to having the music completely pulled out from under us, I got to see this fucking fish scene.
I don't know. Even if Robbie Robertson was dropping some like percussion on it, just something.
Yes, something.
Just something to drive it a little bit.
Yeah, just some sparse,
just a little ambient,
some sparse percussion. I like some Robbie Robertson percussion and a little couple toots of the harmonica to show that he's a little conflicted.
Or just like have audio play in his head of like Pacino dialogue from past conversations they had about how much they fucking love each other. You know what I mean? Like, do something.
Yeah.
Just do like anything, because I'm trying to stay focused. Like, I'm trying to give you the benefit of the doubt. But it is painful. Like, it is utterly... Like, there's a shot where he gets in the plane, okay?
Yeah, yeah.
Sits down.
Yeah.
He's sitting there as the pilot closes the door in real time.
Yeah.
Then he taxis, and we look out through the little porthole window
of
Pesci sitting in the car.
What
and
was
I thought,
it about that I thought, scene? Oh, again.
I loved that shot. And I'm surprised you guys could hear the sound of my heartbeat thumping with the tension I was feeling.
So you were actually feeling tension.
I was.
Okay. See, that's interesting. And I think a lot of people will. And it's just whether or not you get on that track. If you're on that track, you're on that track. If you're off, you go way off.
See,
because
I think
it's so long.
Yeah. I think I would have been on that if we hadn't taken such a long detour into Pacinoville. Because I was enjoying it. I was like, oh, right, this movie. I'm back here. But god damn it. Yeah.
I think the sequence where I really went off the track was the extended Robert De Niro celebration ceremony.
Which seemed to go... Jim Norton?
Yeah, that seemed to go on for at least
30 minutes.
Well,
I would say 30.
And specifically him talking to Pacino at said function, they are continuing to go over the fact that he's mouthing off and that it's not popular and he needs to be careful. That is what the lion's share of this movie this dialogue is about. Yeah. It's, what are we going to do about Jimmy? Jimmy should know better. Well, I talked to Jimmy. Well, why don't you go talk to Jimmy? Oh, why don't you talk to Jimmy? Jimmy knows already.
It became like Zen poetry after a while. It was just like mafia poetry. It was just like,
and it's like,
I don't know what they're talking about, but it's just flowing over me. And,
all these boys are here to play. You got them de-aged, you got them gussied up, you got a huge budget, and all they can do is
keep... It was so good to see Pesci again.
All they can do is keep talking about the same shit. I'll tell you my favorite shot of the movie, my favorite cut of the movie. It's this gangster comes over, disrespects Pesci at the comedy club. They give each other a look. And you know that look because it's in your bones at this point if you've seen any of their movies together. Smash cut to a bed with a bunch of guns on it. God damn it.
Yeah.
That's the movie. Like, come on. Yeah. That's what we came for. And they give you such precious little of that.
Yeah. Well, he doesn't want to do what he did. He doesn't want to retread.
He doesn't want to retread old
ground.
He wants to talk about fish.
I found the last, 45 minutes of the movie? Is that like after he kills Hoffa?
Yeah.
And towards the end, I found that to be the most interesting and compelling to me.
Okay.
Like it was,
let's just put some love and light into this.
It just turned into such like this like quiet meditation on old gangsters, like when they're done, you know? And that's when I really began to like De Niro's character. At that end, I was like, man, this sucks for him because, like, whether you're a gangster or you're like a farmer or you're like an executive, like, being at the end of your life fucking sucks.
For anybody, yeah.
It's just that thing of, like, you know, age and death gets us all at the end. Yep. We're all gonna have
to
go
through some
shit. No
matter how much big dick gangster swagger you have, you're gonna be Joe Pesci sucking on a piece of grape juice bread in a prison cafeteria.
God, it was so painful, too, after Pesci finally dies in prison. You think, okay, we're going to wrap it up. And then, like, there's 30 more minutes. And you're why? Yeah,
that's life. Life extends far beyond dignity sometimes.
We had this Hoffa expert behind us.
On a date. It was like a Tinder date.
Set it up.
And he knew all the people that were dying.
Live, it was Joey Gal. It was this Crazy Joe coming out. Watch. And it's like, Crazy Joe. See? It's Crazy Joe. I knew it. I'm right.
They pop the title card up and says, this guy died at this point, then he turns to his girlfriend. He's like, that's what that is. And then we were like, shh. Like 8 times. And the guy didn't. He just.
And we all know nothing gets women hotter than gangster factoids.
Yeah.
Nothing.
God damn.
It was ironic because I guess, like, it's a Netflix movie. They thought they were at home in their living room.
No one told him to shut up?
Like, dude, I shushed him. I stared the guy down. His woman, like, she quieted, but he was just, like, you know, drinking White Claw out of a bag.
Yeah. I think he drifted asleep because he did shut up for the last, like, maybe 45 minutes.
He was talked out, man. His throat was sore, probably.
I heard some snores.
He didn't help.
There was a big yawn.
We heard
a huge yawn.
A quiet moment in the film. It was like nothing on screen.
It was amazing. De Niro was just wandering through a field or something, and you just hear the biggest. It's amazing.
Did it strike you guys at all while watching it that, like, there aren't gangsters like this anymore because technology just makes it difficult to make people disappear?
Yeah.
That's an interesting point. I wish they would have dug into that a little bit more, even though that didn't bring us up to current day status. But that's really interesting. Speaking of technology, it's painted this way because this is a Netflix film. But how differently would it play if it was chopped up like a body? Like, chop it up, there's the Hoffa episode.
Yeah.
Where you really get into the nuts and bolts, you let Pacino go wild, and then the rest of the arc is taken care of with the other episodes, and then there's a Coda episode where it's the aging.
Oh, you're
and the
saying
dying.
If it was a limited series. It was like a 5-episode.
Because I just don't know how this plays as one movie, and how are people going to watch this at Thanksgiving?
Like, they're not, man. I guarantee you my friends that are super pumped for this, they'll start watching it, and then they'll get distracted or busy because, like, they got wives and children and, like, relatives, and they'll, like, okay, we're going to pause this, but don't worry, we're going to come back to it, and they never will.
Lucas, let me just say, I love the fact that you're in the trunk right now. It's like our conscience, like the dead whacked gangster telling tales from the back there. But I agree. It's like, imagine this. You have Thanksgiving dinner. Your dad is like, it's time for the Irishman. You sit down. I don't know if your dad's a sea captain or what, but he's like, it's time for the Irishman. The family sits down. Dad's asleep pretty quick.
Yeah.
Like, dad's asleep. No, nobody at home is going to watch this without at least pausing it for 30 minutes. So, fuck. I don't know what to say about the prospects. I know there's a lot of talk about, you know,
I was trying to imagine reading the script. Like how, I mean, yeah, it's Scorsese, but, like, if you got that delivered to you and you were, like, opening the PDF and it's, like, 256 pages or whatever the fuck it is, like, how do you even get through that, like, reading those words? Because I can't stress enough. Like, there's not one, like, I take it back. Maybe, like, the one good audition scene is at the very, like, last 30 minutes where he goes to one of his daughters and is like, I'm sorry. And she's like, sorry for what? You know, like, not being a good dad. Well, why weren't you a good dad? Oh, you know. And it's like, but it's like barely anything. Like, it's
the hothead's
so,
fired up.
What about the scene where he calls Hoffa's wife?
Oh, God.
The mumbling.
No, I actually like that scene.
No.
Dude, incredible.
Come on. No, I thought that was De Niro's best point, probably.
I wasn't with that. I was not with that.
He was kind of mumbly through the whole movie too, but that kind of ratcheted up.
Mumbly cubed.
No, because then he was actually had kind of a conscience, and he was struggling to explain what he'd done.
I would say that's an audition scene, Lucas. Come on,
that's an audition scene.
I would love to see De Niro audition for something at this age. All right, well, let's go to the damn Irish Bones. Fuck, are we gonna start with? Let's blow out the airlock and clear out whatever Lucas has to say. Corpse in the back.
I'm sorry for yelling in Josh's and Brother Dave's ears.
I
saw this trailer once and I was like cringy. I was like, ooh, this is the movie? Like, fuck, it does not look good. Like, aesthetically, production value wise, like, Netflix has this cheesy fucking TV sitcom soundstage gloss, and I don't know what the fuck it is, but there's, like, no grit or grain or noise, like, visually or something. Mm-hmm. Like, it just, so yeah, I had pretty low expectations going in, And from that opening fucking shot, I was like, really? Like, this is how you're going to start your fucking movie? Like, this clunky ass, like shuffling, like, I'm assuming it's handheld. It's got to be handheld, right? Am I wrong?
It was.
And then the movie starts, and I use, like, starts with air quotes, because the movie kind of never really does start for 3.5 hours.
Digging in.
And, you know, I'm trying to stay focused, but the guy behind me is, like, muttering and, like, mumbling like De Niro, and I'm like, motherfucker, like...
Did you smoke before this, or were you wound tight?
I had a Dr. Pepper, so, yeah, I was riding that caffeine buzz, but I guess I'm so full of, like, angst and rage, like, I just didn't feel it. But there's just no, and here's what's weird. This is how you know you're in a fucking, like, bad place. When there are, I guess, funny moments or amusing moments, and the audience is, like, all around you laughing.
The audience is pumped for the first
hour.
But
I'm thinking, like, what are you guys laughing? This is not a comedy.
It's comfort food. Like, it's like when you eat a bunch of macaroni and you're like,
like,
that's
the on-screen, like, epilogues for, like, oh, they were shot in the head, like, I guess was kind of a funny choice, but, like, it did nothing for me. And... by the time, you get, like, to the end, the only time I actually felt any emotion, like, when I was actually engaged, was when Action Bronson had his stunt cameo as a fucking coffin salesman. And I'm like, where the fuck has this guy been? I could have used Action Bronson, like, hours ago.
Yeah.
And by the time you get to the very end of the movie and De Niro's, like, waiting to die all alone, that's how I felt watching it. I was like, no one's here to visit me. Like,
oh,
there's no
God.
Fucking...
Where
there's
is
no
he,
one,
where is he going to go with
there's
this
no one
bones.
Telling me stories
this
here.
This sounded rough.
We were there with you, Lucas.
I mean, I can't believe this, but, like...
Oh, shit.
Scorsese and Tarantino made the same kind of movie, except Tarantino actually had Brad Pitt, and they were doing shit. And, like, it actually, like, you know, kind of was, like, entertaining by accident. But this movie, like, not at all, man. Like,
that's
not at all.
Enough to...
I'm giving this 1.5 bones.
1.5,
man.
Okay. Oh. It's crazy when we're relieved by 1.5 bones. Okay. Well...
And for the record, my BFF told me...
Oh, shit.
He told me, four-bone masterpiece.
Oh,
it's
what?
Scorsese's most accomplished, introspective, mature film, which is an allegory about America or some
You're
shit.
You're defying the BFF?
Oh, BFF.
BFF, you have never been more wrong, and you can fight me on that.
Oh, damn.
Uh-oh. We'll have BFF on for a Royal Rumble cast at some point. We'll relitigate this
briefly.
I would love
briefly. To hear a BFF voicemail.
Yeah, that'd be great.
I think this trunk's on fire. Can we put this out?
Yeah, let's put the trunk fire out. Thank you for that, LT. All right. Brother Ben, what do you got cooking?
I'm not going to go there.
No.
I was with it for sort of the framing device, as I mentioned, for the wedding road trip, the assassination of Hoffa. I thought that shit was legitimately good. I think Mr. Scorsese is... I mean, his visual grammar is next level. I didn't have a problem with Netflix Sheen, but God damn it, that thing is bloated. It lost me for huge sections.
Lost you for years.
I'm going to give it a respectful 2.5 bones.
There you go. There you go. With respect to
yes.
Marty.
Yes.
And crew. Brother Bischke.
My expectations were high.
Okay.
I loved Wolf of Wall Street. I thought Silence was his late career masterpiece.
Shut the fuck up.
And I will fight people over that.
That's a one-bone movie, Bischke.
I will fight you over that.
It's a four-bone movie.
It's a four-bone. It's at least 3.5.
No.
What?
Yeah.
Dude, I'm Catholic. I saw that on Christmas Day.
I don't care what you wanted
to walk out.
I don't care what you...
LT, I'm with you.
There's no drama in that movie.
I saw it twice. I love it. Anyway, okay, we're not going to rehash Scorsese's career, because I love him. I love the guy.
So do I.
And...
I used to, at least.
What's the deal?
Talk
about the Irishman.
The Irishman, yes.
Although the title card is I Heard You Paint Houses, so what's up with that shit?
Well, I think that's the title he wanted, probably, but they wouldn't let him get away with that.
Mm.
But it's like, I heard you watch paint dry. No, but anyway. So, I know. I just had to say that. But okay, so then it's like a slow fade. My bone count.
Mm-hmm.
It's just slowly fading throughout the movie. It doesn't It's not peaks and valleys.
No.
There are good scenes.
The bones just got more and more brittle.
It was like
De Niro's bones.
It started very high, very cozy. I was very much on board. I thought it looked great. I thought the production design, and you know, they spent $180 million on this movie. So,
yeah.
But it started to fade, and then by that De Niro appreciation sequence, then it was really fading, and then by that. The kill of Hoffa, then it was really fading.
How low can you go?
No, but I'm going low, so I'm going to go as two bones.
Two bones. He went down to two.
Yeah.
You know, people are going to be scandalized by this podcast.
But why is he immune to criticism? Like, critics are going nuts for this anyway.
But people often, but the people who will scold us the most won't have seen it.
Yeah, yeah.
So, that's something to think about.
Yeah.
Brother Josh? How's that cherry popping going?
I mean, you know, I'm happy to be in the Prius.
Yes.
You know, this is my safe space after that movie.
Oh yes.
Listen.
Tell it to us straight.
Admittedly, do not mesh well with mafia movies.
Okay. Good to know.
Brother Ben showed me Goodfellas a couple years ago, and I was not a fan.
Wow.
And so to me, like, this felt, for good or ill, like a three-hour Goodfellas.
Yeah, three and a half.
Is there room in the trunk for another guy?
and like, I admit, like, you know, Scorsese is a master. You know, he understands movies, he understands the craft, he knows how to do it. I don't know what happened. I think maybe if this movie had been like an hour and a half shorter,
yeah,
that could have helped,
because like a road trip to go kill Jimmy Hoffa in 90 minutes would have been powerful.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Amazing.
No, we're talking about 90 minutes, yeah. Shorter, not 90 minutes.
Yeah,
right.
And like, it was just like the sequences with, like, you know, the schmaltzy music and like the, hey, and like, you know, we gotta take care of this, and I'm like, okay, all right, whatever, like, this is what I signed up for, like, I know what I'm getting into. And you know, like I said earlier, like, the ending is really what I vibed with, mm-hmm. the most, because like,
so your bones got more calcium rich toward the end.
I wouldn't be so sure about that.
Okay, all right.
But like Brother Bishke, I loved Silence. And so coming Silence, I was like, wow, like, I'm ready for this, like, really mature, interesting, spiritual Scorsese. And
you had a fish in the bag.
And I got...
What kind of fish was it?
And I got a little bit of that with that, all that stuff about, you know, Frank at the end of his life. And,
yeah.
You know, I thought it was really beautiful, but... The rest of that movie was unwatchable. 1.5 bones.
Whoa! Yeah. Nice. Nice. Drawing some blood.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm prepared to wake up with a horse head in my bed tomorrow morning.
It's going to be a horse head. Dude, it's going to be a horse head in your Instagram.
I have a framed Scorsese poster in my living room.
All right.
I'm like,
all right, corpse. You got whacked a long time ago. Brother Dave, counterpoint.
Yeah, I think that movie, I you know, I can't argue with you guys that it was long and at times maybe a little repetitive, and it's familiar because it's in that milieu of Goodfellas and Casino, but it takes a really hard left turn, and I don't know if it's because I'm feeling older, but I could relate to the creakiness of these characters.
So creaky.
In a way that I actually never related to the characters in his other gangster movies, you know.
You feeling creaky? You feeling like a creaky gangster these days, Dave?
A little bit, you know.
I think we all are.
So, in that way, it was really fascinating to see these as more human figures. And yeah, I just feel like, despite its ups and downs and peaks and valleys, there's so much that it was a grand feast that he created for us. And I cannot wait to revisit it.
Whoa.
I wouldn't put it on the level of the earlier masterpieces, but there's just a lot going on, especially, you know, as Josh pointed out, I feel like that last 45 minutes or so takes it to this whole new level that I think pays off, not in a, like, kinetic way that we're used to with Scorsese, but in a more subdued and depressing way.
Yeah, and, from a director who knows he's about to kick it.
I give it four bones.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. I love it. Have we ever had... Did Lucas, did you go one or one and a half?
One and a half.
Okay, yeah. So we've gone from one and a half to four.
It's about the widest
range. That's a great range, you guys. That's a great range. Well, I saw a billboard today where the pull quote was something like, Scorsese is functioning at full power, or something like that. And, I mean, he's going full power, but in a direction that some of us didn't necessarily want him to take, and not the route that we wanted him to take either. Like, De Niro is plotting their road trip, and he's taking a very interesting route to from Philly to Detroit. And that's what I feel like this movie did. Like, we know where it's going, and the route took us through some deep Pacino that, I don't know, I just wasn't ready for that. And I do feel like 90 minutes could be excised from this 3.5-hour movie, and it would be better for it. And I don't like saying that.
I looked at my watch 80 minutes in?
Yeah.
For the first time, but not the last?
Yeah, not the last.
I think we need to talk about Al just for a second, because for me, that was maybe the best version of Maximum Al.
Yeah.
Except for maybe Heat.
It was Maximum Al, but it was so much. Like, imagine if he was a spice that every time he showed up, you're like, oh, there's Al again. What's he got cooking? Instead of Al's in his pajamas again, talking about being slighted, talking about people being late for meetings again and again.
Yeah, see, it wasn't like a performance issue with me. It was just the sheer amount that he, like, it was just wall to wall.
Like, oh, is he going to call another guy a cocksucker?
He is. Wow. Spoiler alert, he is. So my bone count was dropping too, and I was very aware of it. And I don't like that happening during a Scorsese movie. I don't want to be focusing on my bones. I want to have this master taking care of me. And Jesus Christ, maybe it's because I'm an editor, but I was cutting. My fingers were cutting shit. My fingers were slamming down on out points for scenes. Just please, please. Please don't mention people being late for meetings again. Please don't talk about the fish anymore. So,
did he like ice cream? I don't know.
Oh, he loved ice cream. And I do want a sundae now, so there's that.
I do want a sundae.
Do y'all want a sundae?
I want a chili dog.
I want the best chili dog in America.
Yeah.
But as it is, if I watch a 3.5-hour movie and I say without hesitation that you could lose 90 minutes of that, I can't go above 2.5, but I'm going to give it 2.5 out of respect. Out of respect. And I don't know if I'm ever going to watch it again. I'm going to give it 2.5, wash my hands of the situation, move on. You guys, this has been a scintillating discussion. This is going to be one that all the Lodge family is going to rumble about. I just know it. There are... Brother Zach,
I have no idea.
We all wonder. Okay, let's guess. Let's just guess. I told everybody.
Zach's giving it 3.5.
I told everybody, moratorium on texting him. Don't tell him shit. If he asks you what you thought, I want to know the straight bone count from the man.
A mutual friend of Zach and I also gave it 4 bones. So Zach's way up in the clouds already.
Okay, so he's ready to love it.
Yeah. Zach's 3.5.
3.5? Does everybody agree?
I say 3.5.
Okay. I say he's docking. He's docking it for length. He's going to go 2.5.
What?
No.
Okay.
Now, after his argument over defending Marty over his Marvel slights, I think Zach is so on board the Scorsese train.
He might even go full. Well,
that's the real question, is how did this compare to Avengers Endgame?
It's past midnight, guys, and this was a 7:30 showtime, so... Ooh. This has been our evening.
I gotta go wake my mom up to, like, get her MacBook up and running. She got locked out of it. That's my fucking hell I'm going into. My night's not even over.
This is gonna be a hotly contested one, folks. So, you gotta see it, though. I think if you're listening to this and you love movies...
It's Marty.
You gotta contend with it. You know, you gotta know what's up. You gotta be part of the conversation. So, let us know what's up. Hey, and let us know what's up, you know, in the iTunes. Give us an iTunes review. If you've been listening to this, we bust our balls every week to give you entertainment.
We want those SoundCloud comments.
Give us some SoundCloud comments. Give us 5 stars on iTunes. And write a review. Write a goddamn review. What do you do?
Bishki, break your legs.
Yeah, Bishki will break your legs if you don't do it, okay? He knows who's listening. He knows who's being naughty, who's being nice. Just write the goddamn review.
I'll sit in the back seat. I'm sitting in the back seat, all right? I'm sitting in the back
seat. But there was fish back there.
Hey, I'm sitting in the back seat.
I'll wait 10 minutes for a guy.
But not 15. Love and light, y'all. Let's go to sleep.
Good night.
Your call has been forwarded to an automatic voice message system.
Hi, this is Lucas's BFF, and Lucas asked me to call in, I think as a counterpoint to his incorrect take on The Irishman, which is to gangster movies what Unforgiven was to Westerns, except that as much as I love Unforgiven, Irishman is somehow even better than that. Now, it's not as exciting or as exhilarating as Goodfellas or Casino, but I think to a point, The Irishman is more measured with a different point of view because Frank Sheeran isn't really a high-level guy. He's more of an enforcer, so at least it's different from that perspective in that sense. It's less ironic, it's less cynical, and more concerned with slowly building up the scar tissue accumulated by the crimes of Sheeran and his contemporaries and the real damage not just doing to the world, but the, you know, themselves. You know, I told Lucas this after I saw the movie, and, you know, for 3 hours you're sitting there and you're telling yourself, this is great, but it's not Goodfellas, it's not even Casino great. But then the last half hour happens, and you have this final chapter that presents maybe the most mature, introspective, and maybe even most allegorical that Scorsese's ever been. And so with that, I think it's a four-bone masterpiece, and while it's not my favorite movie of his, it's quite possibly the best film he's ever made. I mean it. Go see it, and go see Parasite. Good night, everyone.
Lodgecast, Brother Dave, it's Brother Sluice. My ears are ringing. Let me weigh in on The Irishman. I had no idea we were going to be watching a film about Jimmy Hoffa going into it. Took me a ways into the movie until I figured out not just that, but that we were watching it from the perspective of a man who supposedly whacked him. And that got me really excited. I love the period. I love Scorsese in this period. And I love all the union politics juxtaposed with the gangster politics. It was like an existential, mournful reflection on all of the gangster movies he's ever made. And I had no idea that it would be this damn funny. Those bickering scenes about the meeting in Miami and how you dress for a meeting, it just ratcheted up. I was losing it. I had no idea we'd be getting a De Niro and Pacino best performance in decades. Joe Pesci's back. So subtle, so compelling. A gift. Marty's best film since Casino, no question. Honestly, how exciting is it to be getting this kind of a film from Scorsese this deep into his career? Was it a bit long at times? Sure. Could the relationship with his daughter have been deepened? Absolutely. Was this a masterstroke from one of our best filmmakers? No fucking question. I'm going to give it 3.5 bones for each sweet, sweet 3.5 hours. I recommend the shit out of it to anyone within the sound of my voice who has a chance to see it in theaters instead of their couch. And the prestige gauntlet rolls on, my friends. That's all for now.